To millions of people around the world, this was Cuba, a land of song and dance and gaiety, a land of friendly people. The charm, the fame of this tropical island, this paradise of the Caribbean, made Cuba one of the great tourist attractions of the world and made friends for Cuban people everywhere. Cuba's visitors from other lands were impressed by Havana, one of the liveliest cities of the Americas. They found that in the first half of the 20th century, the Cuban people had built a modern nation. Their skills had built industries and made Cuba's standard of living as high as any in Latin America. Visitors who toured the countryside found other evidences of wealth, the sugar and tobacco, which Cuba could trade for industrial and consumer products of other nations. They saw modern agricultural methods applied to a rich soil in an ideal climate. An abundance of crops, of cattle, poultry, and modern dairy farms. Enough food, it would seem, for all. But far from the gaiety of Havana, concealed by the agricultural wealth, there were things the visitors did not see, did not know about. Throughout this wealthy island paradise, thousands of Cubans lived in wretched poverty. This poverty was bad enough. But to the Cuban people, there was a greater evil. For 60 years, the Cuban people had lived under a succession of corrupt and often dictatorial rulers. The latest and worst of these was Batista. He had turned Cuba into a police state. For 7 years, the resistance of the Cuban people mounted. Fidel Castro emerged as the leader of the resistance movement. Cubans of all classes joined the guerrilla bands forming in the mountains and in the underground and in the city. Excitement and hope spread among the people as the fighting at last began to turn against Batista's soldiers. On January 1st, 1959, Batista the dictator was overthrown. Fidel Castro's arrival in Havana was triumphant. He was the hero, the liberator of the Cuban people. He promised them the things they had longed for and had fought for. Elections, land reform, freedom. An end to oppression and bitter poverty. He promised that every Cuban would at last enjoy the rights guaranteed under the Constitution of 1940. The future looked bright when Manuel Urrutia, a greatly respected judge and a liberal, was named president. When Castro went soon to the United States, he was greeted enthusiastically as a Cuban nationalist hero. He paid his respects to Abraham Lincoln, to government of the people, by the people, and for the people. press conference in Washington, Castro denied a rumor that he was a communist.
I know you are worried. First of all, if we are communists. And of course, I have said very clear that we are not communists. Very clear.
But for a man who denied he was a communist, Castro, back in Havana, acted strangely. He made veiled threats against any hint of opposition to a people still shocked by the terror of mock trials and executions. He began attacks on the press, which led finally to confiscation and complete government control. As the free press disappeared, the communist paper Hoy was forced upon the people. Communist propaganda flooded the country. In January 1960, the Soviet deputy premier, Anastas Mikoyan, came to Havana. The stage had been set for him. Mikoyan opened a Russian trade fair. He discussed deals with Cuba. By the time he had put this hat on his head, he had the Cuban economy in his pocket. In Moscow, an agreement was signed for the exchange of Soviet machinery and technicians for Cuba's sugar and other big money crops. The agreement was signed for Cuba, not by a Cuban, but by a communist from Argentina, Che Guevara. From now on, the Cuban economy would go into a critical decline. The life of the Cuban people would become harder than ever. To the hungry Cuban people, the Russian ships brought guns and more guns. As weapons continued to pour in, life got harder for the Cuban people. There was less food, but there were more and more Russian tanks.